weren't the Reaganites in a position to put some of their people in control of the Fed? Wasn't Volcker, wasn't he one of these? Didn't he go right along with this type of policy?
Even though
he came in under Carter, wasn't
no.
he?
The answer is no. Volcker was horrified at all this. This, what he thought was irresponsible fiscal action, would lead to more inflation. I mean, his life's goal was to halt inflation, and deficits help create more inflation. And so he felt his responsibility was to be even tougher and be even more stringent in terms of monetary control to try to offset the bad effects of that fiscal policy. And of course, there came a time, and those times varied, when the Reaganites didn't like Volcker. And as a matter of fact, things got bad enough so that they refused to reappoint him. And they didn't like him. Meanwhile, yes, as the people went off of the Federal Reserve System, Board of Directors, Board of Governors, the Reaganites replaced them. But they didn't necessarily replace them with people that were a whole lot different.
Well, let's take a look at the Federal Reserve, because there was so much ignorance about it, so much secrecy involved in it, and yet people want to know what it is, how it works, and who runs it.
Well, let's start off by looking at this book and this title,
All right.
Secrets of the Temple. And so what Greider proposes to do is expose the secrets of the way the Fed is run, who runs it, and why, and what the bad effects are, and the temple, run out of the temple. The temple is thought of as the Federal Reserve System mausoleum on Constitution Avenue in Washington. If you've ever been in that building, you will be impressed. It's all marble. And, of course, it was built because the Federal Reserve has a bottomless pocketbook. The Federal Reserve has all the money it knows how to spend, is not responsible for anybody to tell how that money is spent, and can blow that money any way they want to, and they do.
Well, it can create money.
Well, it creates the money, but the money it spends is tax money. It's tax money. It's not created money. Those are separate. The Federal Reserve can't just print money and spend it. It doesn't do that. What it does is expand the money supply, let the banks print the money, and then it, by the process of creating the money supply, it gets government bonds, which it gets the interest on, and that's what it spends for its own expenses.
Well, that's its own expenses, but it can interject more money into the system.
Yes.
Correct.
Well, I was speaking of the great marble mausoleum that was spent by its own internal money, but once again, that's the temple. And the whole Federal Reserve System is unaccountable, is undemocratic, is conducted perniciously and incompetently, and has been against the best interests of this country almost since its creation. And yet, it is never called to account for its bad practices and policies.
Well, let's talk about its creation. And particularly in the book, The Secrets of the Federal Reserve, it talks about how the Fed came about, but from a rather circuitous way.
Well, that's true. The whole notion of the word Federal Reserve System. Every other country in the world has a central bank, and the purpose of a central bank is to conduct monetary policy, and that's what the Federal Reserve does. But in 1914, the bankers would not let the public have any say, and do not let the public have any say, in the monetary policy of the country, and therefore they created this weird monster called the Federal Reserve System, made up of 12 regional banks, each of which set its own policy, and that was kind of the way they did it in the early days. Later, the policy accreted partially to Washington, so that it was shared by Washington and by these 12 central banks, these 12 regional banks.
Now, in the history of it, according to Mullins, there was a National Monetary Commission set up to try to come up with some new type of central banking system, or some system that would take the ability of the big banks, particularly J.P. Morgan et al., to play their games and cause panics and deflations, and which were hurting the general populace. And the commission didn't do anything until after there was a secret meeting of the nation's largest bankers, plus Senator Aldrich, who was connected with the Rockefeller family.
And who was very influential in that National Monetary Commission.
Mm-hmm. And they got together in tremendous secrecy off Jekyll Island in Georgia and came up with a system of which evolved into the Federal Reserve. Now, there were some... they didn't get this passed the way they wanted to. The Aldrich bill put this... tried to get this passed. It was not passed, but then later, after Woodrow Wilson came in, they came up with another bill which was quite a bit like it. And much to the, the banks and in other parts of the country, in the South and West, were against it because they didn't want control from Wall Street. But it was the same group, basically, it was on Jekyll Island, who behind the scenes helped to develop the Fed as it became, and as Paul Warburg, who was the principal person on the Jekyll Island scheme, he helped to put this together and said, well, it isn't all that we wanted, but we'll be able to take care of these with administrative actions. And it was then the bankers who, in fact, took over the Fed and who took over as the main stockholders in the Fed. So they really got what they wanted, and they've had it that way ever since.
Well, in 1904, there was a panic, and somewhere in 1904, 1905, and Theodore Roosevelt went to J.P. Morgan and said, can you bail the country out?
Yeah.
Well, J.P. Morgan had always done it before. The Wall Street correspondent banks had always done it before, but this year they had a hard time doing it. And so it became obvious that the country was too big for these correspondent banks to do that. And so that's why that commission was formed up. But the Republicans were still in control and refused to make any real changes until Wilson was elected, the Democrats were elected. And then, of course, they perverted the original intent of having a central bank into the abortion that we see now, which is the Federal Reserve System.
But as like in D.C., all the congressmen say the banks never lose. The banks were able to get in and get control and run it for their benefit ever since.
That's right. And what that does is point up the temple aspect of this thing, that the Federal Reserve is treated like, even by the press and by the public, as some kind of a magic arrangement and a religious arrangement, and maybe like the Catholic Church. The chairman is the Pope. And the various members of the Open Market Committee are the bishops and the cardinals, and they go around speaking this Latin language and doing these strange things, all of which is supposed to be good for us and preordained, and so we shouldn't question it or pay much attention to it. And that's the way it works. 33% of the people in a recent poll appear to understand that the Federal Reserve is the one that controls the money supply, meaning they're the ones that control the economy. The other 66%, I don't know who they think does it, but they don't know that the Fed does that. And the Fed is in total control of the economy. The government isn't, the president isn't, Congress isn't, the Federal Reserve is. Mm-hmm. And they do it in a secretive way, in an undemocratic way, in a way that suits their own purpose and their own very narrow clientele, which is the rich people and the bankers and the Wall Street people.
Yeah. It's significant for people to realize that the Federal Reserve is actually a corporation. It is owned, there's stock ownership. Matter of fact, you said 66% about the people. It's interesting that 66% of the stock is owned, according to Eustace Mullins in the mid-80s, by 10 banks. And so if they're like usual corporations, you can control a corporation real easy by owning that much. Some of these banks are also European banks. But these banks which own that much of the stock, I'm talking about the New York Fed, which is the main one, they are also interlocked through interlocking directorates and through family alliances. So it's a fairly cohesive group of financial organizations that we're talking about there.
Yes, and it's Greider argues that the function of the Fed is to instigate depressions, to reduce inflation, to increase unemployment in order to keep wages down. His position is that that there is no interest at the Fed, never, ever, in economic growth or expansion. It's always in terms of, is inflation picking up, and do we need to tighten the money supply? And the reason is, of course, that the bondholders who stand to lose by inflation are in control of the system, and the Wall Street people that deal with the bonds. That's Greider's argument, and it's a pretty persuasive argument that those are the people that are running the economy of the country to the expense of the rest of us.